Welcome back, Troglodytes, to your daily dose of guitar information, the Trogly's Guitar Show. Today we have an episode that is brought to us by Randy Leonard, a former employee of Gibson back in the cool years. That's right, we're talking the late 70s and the 80s. Whenever we talk about these little initials right here on a guitar, that's the father and son team that we're talking about today. And we've done other episodes in the past featuring some of the cool guitars in the archive, but let's see what he shared with us today. A couple of years ago, we featured this one, a Gibson US-1, which is kind of like Gibson's highest-end super strat that they ever made. They were generally very fancy guitars, with either flame or quilt maple tops. I actually have one of these in my personal collection now. But this unique series was painted by a guy named James O'Connor, and apparently he was custom commissioned for quite a few guitars in the late 80s, and that's what Randy wanted to share with us today. So besides these 20 custom US-1s, his first custom job was actually to paint SG in a galaxy theme. Now, unfortunately, these photos aren't the best, but hey, it's better than being lost to time completely. So our first one, we got a whole bunch of stars, galaxies, some swirls back there, and the Earth painted on that thing. I would bet that would be a really sweet SG in person, but yet, if it ever shows up on the used market, most people are just gonna think it's been like custom painted after the fact. So that one I thought was pretty cool. But then we go over to this one. Oh, that one's my favorite right here. You got a lot more of the same stuff, but then you have like this weird, strange alien purple planet going on. Maybe even another like light burst right here. It's kind of hard to tell if that's gold or chrome hardware. I'm gonna guess it's chrome. Unfortunately, we only have two of these, but Randy says there were at least five of these Galaxy Outer Space Scene SGs done. I don't think I'd mind owning one of those myself. But these were like the 61 reissue style SGs. Now I gotta remember, there wasn't like an official custom shop as we see them yet today at this time, but this was like the highest end SG at that particular time. I've reviewed and documented quite a few of them, but one of the more interesting one was this. You know, there's a lady on here. Is this a Jim O'Connor custom paint work? No, it's not. This was actually, I think, some sort of an art contest if I remember correctly. And the winner of it ended up selling the guitar. I got a hold of it and then I ended up moving it on, but it was an awesome guitar, right? From a very interesting period of Gibson history. But this SG perfectly transitions to what else Jim O'Connor was custom commissioned to do. We'll start with our first one right here. We've got a cowgirl on a piercing blue guitar. But before we go through and see all these custom paint jobs that they've done, we need to understand what is even this model, because there's no binding along here. It's got binding on the fretboard. It appears to be made out of ebony. It's got the custom block style inlays, all done up in mother of pearl. It's got the gold hardware. So is it a studio custom? Because we've talked about those before. It's basically a thinner bodied Les Paul custom built to more studio specs. Those things are awesome. You can check out these reviews and demos to learn a bit more. But no, those things generally did not have anything fancier than dot inlays. So I guess potentially this could be like a souped up version of one of those. It could also just be a regular Les Paul Studio from the late 80s that had been modified a little bit heavier. However, no, this is actually a Les Paul Custom Light. The original run in the late 80s looked like this. It had binding on the top, but it was a thinner body, you know, very similar to an SG. Gibson later reintroduced these in 2013 and made a few runs until about 2016, and so far they haven't brought it back. However, it wouldn't surprise me if eventually they do, but the thing that made these even more fancy is the fact that we had a coil split switch on here so you can get more single coil tones. So thinner body, they didn't have any like access heel carves on these things or anything, and these things looked the part. From the front, they had all the blingage on the headstock as well. So according to Randy, these were Les Paul custom lights that just didn't have the binding around the body because they wanted to give the artist the full range to go over everything. So that makes these fascinating under two aspects. A, custom artwork, whether you like it or not, that's up to you, but B, a bindingless custom light. Now I do vaguely remember there very recently being on the used market a red one of these that did not have binding, and I'm curious if it had been repainted over one of these. We're going to see a few different colors within these because there were six of these guitars. Randy calls this one the cowgirl, and it's his favorite. Next up, what do we got? Something more wholesome than just a nice lady working on a farm? Nope, now we've got something a little bit crazy. Randy calls this one Catwoman. Since no official names were given to these by Gibson, he just had to make his own up. This kind of has some interesting like Halloween vibes to it because you have like this mythical creature type going on here. I love the fact that they incorporated more of the body into this. So her nails are scratching through the backside of the guitar. That would be kind of cool to have like a flame top underneath here and just like expose that. But no, this is just all airbrushed on. And on this one, you can actually see the coil split switch a little bit easier. to further identify this as a Les Paul Custom Light. Now, strangely enough, this is just a floating head here. There's no body to this lady. So calling it a mythical creature, probably a good idea. Now, I would love to believe this is like some sort of like a cloud spray painted on the guitar, but it's probably just reflections of the light. But it would add to the whole atmosphere of this one. I just love seeing these old Gibson factory photos. You know, these are when these things were brand new. Who knows what they look like yet today? Moving on to number three is what he called Tough Girl. Brace yourself for this one. Yeah, so that's his dad holding this very, very interesting piece of Gibson history. It would definitely take a very eccentric player to want to use this one on stage, but the blinding red finish works pretty well with this particular guitar, not having the binding and everything. Still has the gold hardware and everything, and then you've got your punker rock lady dominatrix stuff thing going on. I'm not gonna ask any questions. She's even got her little whip there. But I would have loved to have seen the artist, like, incorporate these knobs in the design somehow. Like, maybe she's holding one of them or something? Or make it as doofy as, like, making the eyes of somebody. So who knows, maybe that one that I vaguely remember seeing recently was this guitar, but refinished. Who knows? Moving right along here. I would say this is actually one of my more favorite ones. Because A, we have the very classic white finish. It works great on a Les Paul custom style instrument with your gold hardware. Now I'm not gonna say the artwork is necessarily my style, but the light blue on top of that, the wispy hair all over this entire guitar, it works. That is a very unique design. Randy likes to call this one Blue Lady. The mouth's a bit scary, but everything else is okay. If some of these designs were a little bit too far out there, check out Elegant Lady. Now this one I would call Mrs. Elvis because that's almost the Elvis hair going on there. But you know, it's just your classic lady. I'm not quite sure why you'd want that on a guitar. But hey, if you're an artist and Gibson says, hey, make us six guitars with ladies on them, you're gonna do your best in trying to vary these things up. And the last one, put your kids to bed for this one because he says the last one is affectionately known as the boob guitar. Which the family friend had to hold this one for photos. So, naked ladies on Gibson Les Paul Customs. It has happened a few times. It's part of Gibson history. It's also part of Fender history with the Marilyn Monroe Stratocaster. We've actually seen this one in the wild fairly recently. I think it was for sale. And I just absolutely hated this because I would have called it the monkey lady guitar. Because like the proportions are just very off on this drawing in general. The face just, it reminds me of a monkey. Even the hand was not quite finished on this one, which I'm guessing that might have been like an artistic liberty here, but it just seems so unfinished on this one. Because that one, it looks good. Clearly a competent artist. I would say that face is pretty good as well. This one might be scary, but looks nice. Windy here, okay, you can start to see the monkey face come back. Miss Elvis, I think that's just the style. But then this one's just definitely the ugly duckling of the batch. You needed to spice it up somehow. And now that segues us into this one. There is a $200,000 ukulele made by Gibson currently on Reverb right now. How do you make a ukulele so expensive? Well, you put a whole bunch of mother of pearl over everything. You do it over the entire fretboard with some lovely scenery. You make your totally oversized Gibson logo emblazoned with some jewels in the fleur-de-lis symbol, and you bedazzle around the edges too, just for good measure. You give the binding on the neck. You emblazon the side with very similar things as our fretboard, but even more artistically. You give it pearl tuners. You give it a pearl stinger back here. And I love the fact that it's a custom shop original here, so you know it's legit and a total one-off. It appears we might even have a two-piece flamed neck on this one. And then you put a naked lady on the back. These guys just went crazy in the early 90s. We've actually seen a few Les Paul Customs done up very similar to this, but generally they don't sell for that much because they're just a bit too gaudy for most collectors. But I thought it was absolutely fascinating to see one of these on a ukulele. That's definitely a first for me. Now, unfortunately, this listing has been pulled by Reverb since the photos weren't censored. So Weber Shop in California, I bet they still have it if you're really interested, but do I think it's really worth how much they're asking? Probably not, but it's still worth a good sum. Because to fully understand these pieces, you have to understand Gibson history. Gibson changes hands to new ownership in the mid-80s, and they have a couple of years where they're like, we have no idea what we're doing, but we're gonna try everything. That's when you get like the weird Super Strats and Wayne Charvel designed guitars. Until eventually they strike gold with the Les Paul Classic, and then things start getting on the road to reissues and things like that, and it births what we know today. However, that's the same era that art guitars were really birthed for Gibson. Now, that's not to say that they didn't exist previously, but things like what we consider from the Crimson Division yet today, this is really their birthing place. So we've talked like ones like this before, where, you know, super ornate carvings on the top that are relief carved, wrap tails just to make room for everything, fancy Vine of Life style inlays, and once again, nearly naked ladies on the back. And you also see the recurring themes of ones like this that Guitar Chimp is currently selling. They just recently marked this down quite considerably. I think that shows how the general public really feels about these things. So this one even has engraved trem system covers on this. Like, just the fact that this thing has a tremolo is very strange, because Les Pauls generally don't get this style. But here you can see some very similar scapes that you've been seeing on the other ones. This is pretty much the Les Paul equivalent to that ukulele. And there's definitely more of these out here, but this one, there's no naked ladies on it. It's a little bit more tasteful and respectful. Even if the headstock does look a little bit goofy due to this new style of that extra thick black layer here, it was certainly an interesting period of time for Gibson. But all right, troglodytes, I hope you enjoyed taking a look at some of these lost artifacts of the Gibson catalog. Don't forget to like, comment, and subscribe, and we will catch you tomorrow on the next one. Take care.